Welcome. Let us continue our discussion on simultaneous concentration gradient and electrical potential gradient, essentially mass flux under the action of these two simultaneous gradients. Okay. In the previous classes, we looked at the movement of ions under these conditions in a liquid and then across a membrane. Then when we looked at the membrane, of course, it has huge relevance in all that. We saw that. We looked at Nernst equation, applied Nernst equation, and then looked at the condition of Donnan equilibrium with an approximation to the movement that is described by the Nernst equation. Okay, so when there are multiple ions involved. So today, let us look at the electrical circuit representation of a membrane, because this will come in useful for us to understand the what happens with the ion movement across the membrane. So let's take it further. Let us recall the structure of the membrane. We all know this from at least a current viewpoint, Sanger, Nicholson. Typically, a membrane is made up of a lipid bilayer. These lipids have a charged head and an uncharged tail. We all know this. Thus, the lipid bilayer, okay, charged head and an uncharged tail, then a charged head and an uncharged tail, a bilayer. Thus, the lipid bilayer can be viewed as two layers of charges or the heads separated by dielectric tails. Therefore, the very nature of the lipid bilayer makes it an electrical capacitor. Okay, that's a classical capacitor, electrical capacitor. Charges separated by a dielectric. And there are proteins spanning the membrane. Okay, there are many things, but let's look at bilayer of lipids and proteins spanning the membrane. Ions can pass through some specific membrane proteins to cross the membrane. Ion channels, these are called. And this is what is passive transport. Each ion channel can be considered, therefore, to be a conductor of ions that spans the biological membrane. And when you have a conductance, the inverse of that is a resistance. Therefore, you could consider that as a resistor that spans the biological membrane. The total electrical conductance of the membrane is the sum of the conductance of individual ion channels acting in parallel. Okay, so you have various ion channels in parallel, each one with its own conductance or resistance. And when you have resistances in parallel, you know how to find out the effective resistance. That will essentially 1 by R total equals 1 by R 1 plus 1 by R 2 plus 1, so until 1 by R n, we know this. 1 by R is nothing but conductance, therefore the conductance equals the total conductance equals the sum of the individual conductances. That's what this says. Now let us review something that we already know. We need to make sure that we understand this clearly. Electrical phenomena result when charges are separated or when charges move or can move independently. Any flow of charges is called current I, and it is measured in amperes, which is coulomb per second. The current direction depends on the charge sign. Positive direction is the direction of the movement of positive charges. The potential difference delta V between the positive and negative poles and the conductance G, or the conductance is nothing but the inverse of resistance between them, are related by a constitutive relationship which we know as the Ohm's law. Delta V equals IR, or I equals conductance times delta V. Okay, delta V by R, so 1 by R is G, therefore I equals G times delta V. This is equation 6.1.3-1. All this you know, I'm just putting it in a framework that is relevant for us. For a capacitor, the capacitance, that is the amount of charge that needs to be transferred from one conductor to another to result in a potential difference, okay, C by delta V, Q by delta V, okay, that is the capacitance, Q by delta V, the amount of charge that needs to be transferred from one conductor to another to result in a certain potential difference of delta V is given as C, the capacitance. 6.1.3-2. For a parallel plate capacitor formed by two parallel plates of each of area A, and of course separated by a distance D, this approximation is valid for the membrane that is stretched out to form a flat surface. We've already seen that the charges on the sides and the dielectric lipid part of the bilayer in the middle. So for a parallel plate capacitor, and whatever approximation we make from this is certainly valid for the lipid bilayer membrane also. Capacitance is K epsilon naught A divided by D, or K epsilon A divided by D, equation 6.1.3-3. And K is a dielectric constant, epsilon naught is the permittivity of free space, and if you have R on permittivity, you put that in. The typical value for the capacitance of, or let us leave it as it is for now. The typical value for the capacitance of a cell membrane is about 1 microfarad per centimeter squared. You need to know some numbers, right? You need to have a handle on some numbers. The typical numbers, typical value of capacitance of a cell membrane is about 1 microfarad per centimeter squared, which is actually a very large value compared to the normal capacitances that are found in a typical electrical circuit. So 1 microfarad per centimeter squared is actually a very large value. Now, given the picture that we have seen, let us consider only potassium and sodium fluxes across the membrane. Recall that the earlier development were all done in terms of only potassium and sodium. In fact, the experimental results matched the model results so much that people felt these two charges, these two ions, are good enough to for us to understand what happens across the membrane. Let us also say that the fluxes of these two ions are independent of each other, the Hodgkin and Huxley assumption. And if that is these two, if the above is the case, the following circuit, electrical circuit, is an equivalent of the happenings in the membrane. Okay. Now, once we draw an electrical equivalent, we can bring in our electrical engineering principles, techniques to analyze the circuit, and then take it back to the membrane case and expect it to be valid. So that's the reason why we are doing this. So if we know that the lipid bilayer can be represented by a capacitor, simple capacitor. We know that the ion channels can be represented by conductances, resistances, whatever it is. Okay. So, if you take this to be the intracellular side and this to be the extracellular side, we have first represented the capacitance. This is the conductance of the sodium and the Nernst potential of the sodium represented like this. And this is the conductance of potassium and the Nernst potential of potassium that is represented like this. And from our very definition, the intracellular potential minus the extracellular potential is the membrane potential delta Vm. Okay, membrane potential difference, membrane potential delta Vm. So this is the electrical equivalent of the cell membrane, or a typical membrane, let us say. Np is the Nernst potential of the respective ions, and Cm is the capacitance of the membrane. Delta Vm is the membrane potential. The resting membrane potential represents a steady state. We all know this, when there is no net ion flux or ion current across the membrane. However, individual ion fluxes could exist, okay? Because at resting membrane potential, the Nernst potentials may not equal the resting membrane potential. The Nernst potential of each ion is different. That may not equal the resting membrane potential. So each ion could move. The individual ion fluxes could exist. Since the flux for a particular ion across the membrane would be zero only at its Nernst potential, okay? All the Hodgkin and Huxley assumptions said was that the movement is independent of each other. It didn't say anything about anything else. Here, if we start looking at it closer, at the resting membrane potential, the net ion flux is zero. However, individual ion fluxes could exist because the flux for a particular ion across the membrane would be zero only at its nonce potential. And of course, note that the active transport of ions across the membrane through the transporter ions, which occurs at much slower rates compared to that through the ion channels, is not included in this representation, okay, or is not a part of this model. You will have to look at other models to represent active transport. We are limiting our discussion only to passive transport. Now, the ion currents Ik due to potassium or Ina due to sodium at steady state can be represented through the conductance and the effective potential difference. We have already seen that the current is nothing but the conductance times the potential difference. Okay. So, Ik can be written as the conductance of potassium times the effective potential difference. The effective potential difference is the membrane potential minus the potential due to the nonce potential of potassium. Okay. So, this is the effective potential difference. Equation 6.1.3-4. And the current, ion current due to sodium is the conductance due of sodium times the membrane potential, this remains the same, minus the nonce potential of potassium. Okay. Also, let me state this, don't worry too much about it now. For now, when you start working out, this will make sense. Working out problems, this will make sense. Don't worry about the direction here. The directions will automatically take care. That's the reason why we have written both these in the same way and so on. We are taking the net, the negatives and positives will automatically take care of themselves. So, due to capacitance, there would be a capacitive current, of course. And if you recall your basic electrical engineering, the capacitive current is nothing but capacitance times the time derivative of the potential difference, delta Vm in this case, the membrane potential, ddt of delta Vm. So, 6.1.3-6, at steady state, you are not going to have any time derivative, okay, or at the resting membrane potential, the capacitance current therefore would be 0 because this derivative would be 0, okay. At steady state, the sum of the other currents would also be 0, there is no net current, and the membrane potential would be the resting membrane potential, delta Vm r, okay. You have a membrane potential, you have the resting membrane potential at equilibrium, and at the resting membrane potential, which is at steady state, the sum of the other currents would be 0 and the membrane potential would be at the resting membrane potential. So, in our representation, this is the current due to potassium, this is the current due to sodium, Gk delta Vmr minus Npk, okay, the resting membrane potential minus the nonce potential of potassium, that's the effective membrane, the potential difference, plus the conductance of sodium times the effective potential difference equals 0, okay, because the net current is 0. And therefore, delta Vmr, the resting membrane potential, can be found as a function of the individual conductances of ions and the nonce potentials of those ions, or in this case, conductance of potassium times the nonce potential of potassium plus the conductance of sodium times the nonce potential of sodium divided by the sum of the conductances of potassium and sodium directly by transposing this equation, okay, nothing else. So, 6.1.3-7, and note that the above is for ion movement through ion channels. Ions are not permeable at significant rates across the lipid bilayer of the membrane. However, small non-zero permeabilities of the ions exist across the membrane due to the combined forces of the concentration gradient and the membrane potential gradient, and that's away from the nonce potential for that ion. Okay, so that will anyway happen, but the rates are so small that we, even if you don't consider it, it's not a big, it's not going to make a big difference in comparison with other aspects. Thus, when the membrane potential is at rest, potassium ions may move from the inside to the outside of the cell and sodium vice versa. Now, let us work out a quick problem. An animal neuron, or in an animal neuron, the ion conductances at resting state were determined to be for potassium 0.42 millisiemens per centimeter squared and for sodium 0.01 millisiemens per centimeter squared. The Nernst potential for sodium and potassium are respectively minus 74.7 millivolts and plus 54.2 millivolts. This potassium is minus, sodium is plus, intracellular minus extracellular. Find the resting potential for the neuron. Can you go ahead and try this? Pause the video for some time. Please try this and then I'll give you the solution. Go ahead, please. Pause. Okay, this is a closed problem, closed-ended problem. So, what is needed? What is known? We know that the resting membrane potential is this in terms of the conductances and Nernst potentials. And we substitute given values. Okay, what is needed is in this problem the resting potential for the neuron. What is given is the conductances as well as the Nernst potentials are given. How do you equate the two? This equation. Or how do you relate the two? This expression between the resting membrane potential and conductances and Nernst potentials. So we have this. So if we substitute the values, we get delta VMR, GK is 0.42, NPK is minus 74.7 in millivolts. They are all consistent, therefore you don't have to change units here. Plus 0.01 times, that is GNA, minus 54.2 is in the Nernst potential of sodium, plus the conductance of potassium 0.42 plus the conductance of sodium 0.01. Put it all together, you will get a minus 74.2 millivolts. Okay. This is a nice number to remember. Please remember this, minus 74.2 millivolts, the resting membrane potential, a very good thumb rule value. Okay, it's going to be around that. So, just considering potassium and sodium alone, we got to minus 74.2 and the actual membrane potential is very close to that. The actual resting membrane potential is very close to that in mammalian cells. So, that's a good thumb rule value to remember. And let us stop here in the class in which we saw an electrical representation of the membrane, thereby we could use the relationships that are valid for an electrical circuit analysis and then we could get useful insights. Okay. In the next class, we will see directly how the transport of ions across the membrane are related to our the working of our five senses. Okay. See you then.